to all very good morning to all. On behalf of Dr. SNSS Gandhi Government Engineering College Surat and EC department, I welcome you all for the webinar on real time system design using embedded microcontroller. So let me first introduce our eminent speaker, Dr. Pinal Engineer sir. He is presently working as an assistant professor at SVNIT Surat in electronics department. He, if we see the journey of his study, then he did his UG from LD College of Engineering, Ahmedabad. He did his PG from MS University, Baroda, and he got his doctorate degree from IIT Bombay. If we see the research of area of the Pinal sir, then he having wide huge and depth knowledge in FPGA-based system design. His area of research in VLSI architecture for real-time signal and image processing, high-performance embedded computing, embedded and real system design. He published more than 15 national and international journal and conference papers. He has more than 19 years of teaching experience. So, and as per my knowledge, he's a very good personality. He was also my guide in my PG, and he having an in-depth knowledge of embedded system and VLSI design. So now, not wasting much time of I handed over the session to Dr. Pinal sir. So I request Pinal sir, please continue the session on real-time system design using embedded microcontroller. Thank you, sir.
Oh, thank you, Dharmesh, for giving my introduction. And good morning to all of you.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah, so am I able to, I think, you, are you able to see this, my screen?
You are visible, and your audio is also coming great, sir. You start presenting your screen. I will disable my screen.
But right now, I think.
Yeah, you may start your presentation, sir. Fine. Yes, sir. The screen is visible.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, so, great. Go ahead, sir.
Fine. So the my topic of presentation is real-time system design using embedded microcontroller. It seems to be like a very general topic, but as the presentation progresses, I'll be making it more specific towards one of the application. So I have assumed that I think the few participants are students, and we have a blend of faculty member also,
right? Yes, sir, we have faculties and students both.
Right. So with that, I'll start my presentation. That okay, already there, the embedded system is there, and real-time system is we are talking about. Now there is a union between embedded system and real-time system, which is called as real-time embedded system. So right now, first we'll discuss about what real-time means. So any system which, when we can say the system is real-time. So here, let's take a temperature control system is being developed. Fine, we can call it as a system, and okay, it's designed using controller. Then we can call it as a small controller. So it's, we call it as embedded system, and which is fitting in smaller size also. That's why we specifically categorize into embedded system. But it become real-time system when we introduce a notion of time. So like if you take the chemical plant, temperature control is there, and that temperature control is to be achieved in within a 30 millisecond, right? So when we specify the notion of the time, that means it has become now real-time system if it satisfy this 30 millisecond timeline, right? So now the system challenges changes. Earlier it was a temperature controller. Yeah, anyway, it can happen in 1 second, 2 second, even 1 day, that is fine. But when notion of time is specified and the system satisfy that the time constraint, that means now the system become real-time system. That's why we call it as a temperature control is achieved within a 30 millisecond in chemical plant is now real-time system, right? So there are various application of the real-time system. As one of the application we have discussed is a temperature control in chemical plant. So there are such many industrial applications where this real-time system is being used. Other category of application is a medical application. Like one of the application is a, like we call it is an artificial pacemaker. And that is a good example taken while introducing a real-time system is artificial pacemaker has to generate the pulse at 1/72, at every 1/72 second. So that the natural pacemaker doesn't work, then artificial pacemaker can take over. There are various peripheral equipments. Nowadays, I think it is very, it has become general that people, we are using various peripheral equipments like Wi-Fi printer. So Wi-Fi printer connection should happen seamlessly. Even the printing should happen. That is, anyway, it's an electromechanical problem, but we require that all the connection should become seamlessly between the PC or the our mobile phone to the Wi-Fi printer. If that connection won't be seamless, then it should happen within a few seconds, maybe. It should not take 1 minute, 2 minutes even, then people feel annoying, right? Other application is automotive or transportation. There are many such applications like car area network and all this thing. One of the happening application is ADAS, which is called as automated driving assisted system, right? And people are working on the driverless car, right? So ADAS is more towards that driverless car application. Another application for the real-time system is a mobile. Telecommunication applications, mobile. Now we talk about the evolution of those mobile technology from 2G to 5G nowadays. So what we require is all the processing has to be done in the real-time fashion, right? Like the handover mechanism and IP, right? So all those mobile computing related things should also happen in the real time. And that's why the system, why those who are designing a system should satisfy those time constraint criteria. Now, aerospace is one of the earlier application where real time was understood as a basic criteria after the industrial application, right? So one of the application in aerospace is like avionics, where all the control and monitoring should happen real time, so that the automation within avionics can be taking a decision within a second, maybe millisecond or microsecond, right? The next application, which is nowadays happening and which is very popular among the students and research community, is internet and multimedia application. And one of the most happening application is IoT, right? We can combine this IoT and industrial application that become IIoT. So the IoT, now when I say the real-time system is not only the microcontroller what we are talking about, there are other things prevailing. Anyway, that is a separate topic which can be discussed, that how we can make IoT more real-time, fine? So now the first thing which is we understood is there is a time constraint, and that is a prime characteristic of the real-time system. So all the action, all the monitoring should be done within a certain time. It depends, it varies on different applications. Sometimes it is microsecond time, some it is millisecond, sometimes it's 1 second, even 1 hour is fine, right? So there is some time constraint, and that is specific to the application. That's why when we say the time constraint, it is not the time, right? The time is 1 microsecond may not be feasible for certain application, but 1 microsecond is too much high for certain application, where even nanosecond switching activity which is happening that is happening at the nanosecond. And if you look at the data rate which is at the fiber optic, right, so that should happen at every nanosecond or picosecond even, right? And that's why this time constraint is a general characteristic, but the time varies according to the different applications. Now, another characteristic of the real-time system is new correctness criteria. Now, when we say the correctness, means results should be correct, right? Now, when I say the new correctness criteria is, if the correct result comes after, let us take that there is a time constraint that results should come within a 1 millisecond, but that result which is produced by the system within 1 millisecond is not correct, right? So there is not any meaning of those incorrect results, which is anyway coming in the deadline criteria, so time criteria, 1 millisecond, right? And that is why the new correctness criteria is that result within a deadline should be correct, right? And this is what one of the important design aspect for the real-time system, that you should achieve a correct result within a deadline, right? So those who are students, I think this is a very good criteria which is to be focused, right? While designing any system, sometimes we may say, okay, there is accuracy of 80% within the 1 millisecond, but if we take 2 millisecond or 5 second, then accuracy which is obtained should be, will become higher, 100, maybe 99.5 percentage accuracy if 5 millisecond is given, right? So when we emphasize a new correctness criteria, then that 80% is the correctness of the result rather than 99.5% correctness in 5 millisecond, because we are focusing on the 1 millisecond deadline now, right? Other is safety and criticality. So there are two criticality. One is the critical applications, criticality of the system, right? So that safety and criticality is related to the system safety and the system criticality, critical function which is which it handles, right? One of the very good example of this is anti-missile systems, right? So the missile is being launched by the enemy, and then action must be taken within few milliseconds, seconds, right? So if that action is being not taken, then obviously the safety is being compromised, right? And that's why those tasks will become more critical. Now, other aspect, characteristic, prime characteristic, which has become now for most of the real-time system. Earlier, this concurrency was applicable to the large real-time systems like industrial applications. But nowadays, it has become a general that now real-time system is handling many parameters, and many sensors are being read. Now, if we take a case of driver-assisted system, earlier there was a cruise control, so there was one sensor, maybe two sensors, and those two sensors are being read and control is being taken, right? Now, so that is a single variable or two variable control system. Now, when we talk about the driverless car, there are many sensors which are connected, right? Now, all sensors are getting you the reading within at every 1 second or maybe less, and then all the sensor must be handled properly, right? And that should happen within a deadline. So that means there should be some concurrency. Concurrency in parallel processing is somewhat different. So concurrency is all sensor must be handled within that 1 second deadline, right? And that's why the concurrency has become now the prime characteristic of the real-time system, right? Now the task criticality is the critical task which handle the critical thing. Now this 3 to 4 criteria were available for many years as a characteristic of a real-time system. But now if we move towards the miniaturization and embedded application, right? So that's why I told you earlier in the beginning of the presentation that there was the embedded system and there is a real-time system, but the union of those two is embedded real-time systems. So nowadays, many application and many product, people want it as miniature as possible. So the blend of that embedded is now introduced in the real-time systems. So that's why people emphasize that, okay, most of the real-time systems should be embedded in nature, right? So this has introduced much more challenge in the real-time system design. And that's what our focus would be, right? And the next thing which has happened is, as embedded is being introduced, there were too many different hardware types. And as we focus on the miniaturization of the system, people want their own custom hardware to be converted into real-time systems. And thanks to many company and many microcontroller available in the market, so we have many varieties of microcontroller and respective boards available, right? That's why what people want is their own custom hardware, not the development board which is available in market. Their own custom hardware using those microcontroller chip should be converted into real-time systems, right? So that's why when we talk about the real-time system, which is embedded, so it become embedded real-time system more rather than pure embedded or pure real-time systems. So the challenges which are introduced due to the need of embedded in nature, embedded nature of the real-time system and the custom hardware. So let us understood this with the examples. But before example, I just discuss. I think this is people know that, okay, there are different type of real-time systems and they are categorized in the hard, soft and firm. And when I say the hard means the importance of this vertical line here is a deadline and the response time of the system is in the x-axis and the y-axis of the graph is utility or the importance of the output. So if we say I want to design the hard real-time system, that means I should get the response of the system before deadline or maybe exactly at the deadline. But if it doesn't happen within a deadline, the importance of that output would become negative. So if we extend the deadline lines towards negative y-axis towards infinity even, that means the importance of the output in hard real-time system has become minus infinity after deadline. Before deadline, it is 100%. Right. So one of the example we can take is artificial pacemaker. Then if pacemaker doesn't produce output in 1/72 period, that means it's a harm to the human, right? So it may happen the person may be dead if that 1/72 criteria is not satisfied, right? Even the anti-missile system, if it is going to be arriving at the particular city within 10 seconds and no action is being taken in by the anti-missile system in 10 seconds, that means it is huge damage to the systems, right? The soft real-time system is basically, I think we allow that, okay, anyway, the importance may not become minus infinity at the deadline. It will reduce. Like the shown in the graph, that as the response time increases, the importance become 100 to maybe at some time it becomes 0%. Like the web browsing, which we want to do. So we always feel that okay, the page should just appear within a second, right? But if doesn't appear within a second, then our the importance of that page, web page arriving will becoming eventually zero, right? So it will decrease. So it doesn't harm to the system. The firm real-time system is, that's what right now the presentation is happening through the video conferencing. The one of the example of firm real-time system is the video conferencing. So right now we are getting very good bandwidth. So that's why you would be able to see the screen properly and all the videos are coming properly. But if the network is not proper and the processing happening in my laptop or your laptop is not proper, what may happen is we may miss some of the frames. Now, what will happen in that case? Those frames would be lost, right? It's not like the older frames would be stored and the streaming would start with those older frames. It should continue with the live streaming which is happening, right? So in that case, the deadline, after deadline, the importance of that particular frame will become zero. And that's what is only horizontal. And after that, the vertical line. At deadline, the importance of that output becomes zero. And then after that, the output would be discarded. Anyway, this is general real-time systems. Now, continuing with the challenges in the real-time system. This is example I'm also taking for the hardware software co-design, but this is also, I have just taken a different blend of this example in real-time system design. So let us take, there are various sensors, and for each sensors, we have task allocated. So task is, I have to read and process that sensor within a certain time, right? So I have 8 sensors here and associated tasks are T1 to T8. And every sensor reading and processing takes a certain time. Now, how that certain time is being obtained is we pick a particular microprocessor. Let us take, we are choosing the classical 8051 microcontroller. So the software, which we call it as an estimator, right? So the role of that software is estimator, but in general terms, it is called as an instruction set simulator or a debugger or a normal simulator, which we are using. It's similar to the kill simulator. Now, the simulator is having that microprocessor architecture model. In our case right now, it is 8051 microcontroller. And the task is actually one program, which is for the T1. So now the estimator, what estimator will do is looking at all the scenario, all the possibility of if, else, and switch case within that program, it will estimate the worst case execution time. The worst case execution time is considering which if or else condition will take the maximum amount of time, which switch case will take maximum amount of time. And based on that estimate, this execution time is estimated. Right, so this is called as WCET analysis. So whole process is called as WCET analysis. We require that microprocessor architecture model, which is part of instruction set simulator. Right, so from that it is up. We could able to obtain WCET for T1 to T8 tasks, which is 4, 6, 4, 7, 8, 12, 7, 10, and now comes the requirement of the system, right? So we have been told to design the system which will achieve the overall execution of T1 to T8 within a 42 time units. But if we add up all those WCET of 8 tasks, then it turns out that it is 58, which is higher than 42. There is another parameter which is always associated, which is called as a cost. Now, this cost is a general term I have used here. This cost may include the various constraint of the embedded system, maybe the size and power and the cost, physical, the actual cost in the rupees or dollar, whatever we consider, right? And the power consumption. So this cost, which is 4, then expected, the ceiling which is given to the designer is 8, right? So cost comparatively is very less, right? So as we have used 8051 microcontroller, which is physically cost is very low, and then we could able to achieve the whole designs using within a overall cost given of 8, right? So now what we could do is we have to now target on the execution time. The execution time is much more higher. So obvious question come is, okay, why should we use a classical 8051 controller? There are many powerful microprocessor and controller available. So we have to try another architecture, right? So what we did is we have chosen another fast enough processor called microprocessor 2. And for each task, we have now performed the WCET analysis for microprocessor 2 architecture model. And what we obtain is, as microprocessor 2 is faster, what we could see is that T1 execution time earlier, which was 4, now has become 2. Right? So, and other execution time of task is also has also decreased. And what we could see is, using this new architecture, we have a solution which is execution time is far lesser, which is 28, less than 42. Yeah, that is achieved. But the cost parameter has now crossed the limit of 8. Right? So now one may say that, okay, now we have to try another architecture. And this loops, iterates until we find execution time within a limit of 42 and the cost within a limit of 8. Like, so this is exactly the challenge in the real-time system. If we didn't have execution time, right, then the cost, the earlier solution was a perfect, right? Because there is matching the cost of 4 less than 8, right? But as execution time is needed for the real-time system, the embedded system solution was not preferred here. So we have to focus on the real-time aspect of the embedded system, right? So we are focusing on execution time with the microprocessor 2, but suddenly what happened is the cost is increased. So the prime criteria of the embedded system where lower costs should be there, that is not satisfied. So this loop iterates many times, right? And that is exactly what our focus on of this talk, that what architecture should be there for designing a real-time system, right? So the first question arises is, which microprocessor is better? Is a microprocessor 1 or 2? The one thing we could do as a designer is, I think we can, we can just check with the vendor who has given those specs, whether that cost would be okay or not, or that time is okay or not, right? But the functional requirements already specified as a first step of embedded design or the real-time system design, right? So we don't have any choice of going back. The only thing is we have to move forward, right? So neither microprocessor 1 nor microprocessor 2 is suitable, right? That's why there can be another microcontroller which would be better, right? If another microcontroller, whether it should be single or multiple, right? So it could be single. So I think it could be single microcontroller people can find, right? Or it could be multiple microcontroller one can achieve. So there are variety of implementation possibility here, right? Now if we choose a single microcontroller, there are too many choices in the market, right? If we talk about the 20 years ago scenario, then there are few microcontrollers. So I think it's a microprocessor 1 choice was better and microprocessor 2 choice would be better, fine. So we have to either negotiate with the vendor about the functional requirements. But now there are too many choices. That is exactly what embedded system designer, or we call it, right now in context of this talk, is embedded real-time system designer has too many choices. So which controller should be chosen? If person go with the multiple, then there are choices that we replicate the microprocessor one, that become homogeneous. Two numbers of microprocessor one, it become homogeneous. Yeah, other may have a view that why can't we use microprocessor one and two as in this system? So anyway, we are going to the multiple microprocessor. One is running slow, but other is running fast. So we may leverage the benefit of both microprocessor one and microprocessor two in terms of cost and the speed, right? So one may go with the heterogeneous, right? So in this talk right now, what I'm going to focus in is a single microprocessor, how we can design a real-time system using a single microprocessor or microcontroller rather, right? So how can we implement a simple real-time system? So one of the ways, we have those T1 to T8 tasks. And T1 to T8, our task is to be run. So those tasks can be run in the round robin fashion. So we may decide the task T1 run first and task T8 runs at last, right? Other is the cooperative scheduling. So there are two choices we have, is a round robin, and the cooperative scheduling is like a time slicing. So we may allot the time for each task to run. So one time unit for each task, and then next task will take over. That is what the cooperative scheduling is. And the OS, which is installed in our laptop, is basically working on the cooperative scheduling, right? So simple real-time system can be implemented using round robin or the cooperative. So what we have implemented in earlier example was basically a round robin system. Fine. Other thing which we require in the real-time system is it should be reactive also. Reactive means it should respond to the external events, right? Like the car automation is already implemented, fine. But if it is not responding to the collision which may happen at the front of the car, then there is not any meaning of the having automation in the system car, right? So it's like whenever the collision will happen, then airbag would be inflated. So that is where the notion of the interrupts comes, right? So while designing a simple real-time system, we should have a extra facility of ISR, and that is really main requirement of most of the embedded system, and now the ERTS, real embedded real-time systems, right? And that can be easily achieved. Other thing which is there in the simple real-time system is resource sharing, right? So resource sharing is, there is the single resource, but various tasks. Let's take the one of the resources, UART or UART itself. And that resource is to be used by multiple tasks. Then how that single resources can be utilized across various tasks. And that's what we call it as a resource sharing across the various tasks, right? Other challenge is there is a problem with the critical data also, because there is the notion of critical section of the code and critical data, right? Anyway, we are not going to discuss more in detail of critical sharing, critical data and the resource sharing. We'll be focusing on the real-time system design. So this third problem also should be considered while designing the real-time system. So we should also keep this in mind that anytime when we upgrade the system, this resource sharing and critical data is going to come, right? So now we have taken the example where there are multiple tasks. So those multiple tasks are to be handled. So one thing we have decided is we'll go with the single CPU, fine. So what is required to be done is there are resources, which is shared resources, and one of the resources which is also shared but which is implicit is a CPU. Now task is a code which is shared by a CPU. That's why in the real-time system, CPU is also considered one of the resource, right?
Yeah. Excuse me, sir. Sir, you can please start restart your presentation again because someone has taken over your presentation screen. So.
Oh, restart means restart from first slide or?
No. Just start reshare your screen.
It is visible from here. Presentation is visible.
Okay, now it is visible, no?
Yes.
Okay.
Oh, restart is sharing. So now should I continue with this slide? Multitasking on single CPU, someone can respond even.
Sir, just go. Hello? With the login page. And there you will find the resume presenting option.
Okay. Just a minute. Yeah. I think, yeah, someone might have taken over. Right.
Yes.
So resume presenting.
Yes, sir. It's fine now.
Oh, I think someone might have just logged in and then start.
Yeah, by mistake.
Oh, fine.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So we were here. So. What we have is we are discussing a multiple tasks to be handled by the single CPU. So CPU is also considered as a resource, and that's what how the task is being handled by a single CPU. Right. So what is typically done here, considering the CPU would be used by a multiple task, or we can say a CPU is given to the multiple tasks one by one. Right. So sharing that CPU resource by rapidly switching between all the active tasks. So initially, as I told you that there is time slicing routine. So for 1 millisecond, the CPU was given to the task T1. Next 1 millisecond, it is given to the CPU 2, task 2, right? And that is how we can achieve multitasking. And that's exactly what happening in the desktop PC also. But it is happening at very higher rate, maybe at the microsecond. So we won't be able to see what is really happening at a 1 second level, right? So that is exactly what we are going to achieve is called as concurrent processing, right? So what is really happening at the minute level at microsecond or even nanosecond level is this task is sharing a single CPU at a very faster rate. And what we could see is there are many process or task is running in the system, right? So concurrency is just illusion of parallel processing, but actually at the minute level, parallel processing is not happening. Sorry, right? So now, how we could write the program which would achieve multitasking? So that is implemented, it can be implemented by the high-level languages like C, C++, ADA, and other languages are there, right? Now, for real-time system and any other system, one of the important thing is when the particular task is to be handled. So when and how those tasks are to be swapped, and there is some strategy is used to choose which task should run on the CPU. And that is what the main responsibility of the system scheduler, which is a core of a real-time system where multiple tasks are being handled, right? So the last point, which is deciding when and how the tasks are to be swapped and which task will use the resource, is the main thing, right? Now, when you are designing a small real-time system, it is implemented in this fashion, right? Which is, we call it as a cooperative scheduling, or we can say the time slice. So why, what will happen is small real-time system, what we have is we have a loop of the function. That's how we design embedded system. And there are multiple tasks or function which is being run, and there is ever and never ending loop here. So which is traversing from task one, task two, task three, and somewhere between this loop, the interrupt may come and ISR 1 or ISR 2, 3, so on would be called, right? So here what will happen is, what we are doing is we are running the task 1 first, then task 2, task 3. It is actually a round robin fashion super loop, right? Why this is beneficial, that beneficial because we are actually avoiding switching from task 1 to task 2 and task 2 to task 3 in between. So we let the task 1 to complete its execution and then task 2 takeovers, right? And that is how the super loops in the small real-time system can be implemented, right? Now in this super loop, how the interrupt driven task will run, because we have an interrupt ISR1, right? So some external interrupt may come even while task 1 is executing. It may come later when task 2 is executing, or it may come late even when task 3 is executing. So what could be done is, in this case, the ISR would preempt the task 1, 2, or 3, depends on when it arrives, right? ISR should be served first, then task 1, 2, and 3, right? So there should be a timely service of all its ISRs, right? So that's why we have to write a special subroutine, right, which will, which does not hamper the normal execution of task 2, task 2 and task 3. That's why many times it is suggested that this ISR should be as small as possible, so that it will not hamper the normal execution of the task, and it will finish within a small time unit. And that's why designing ISR routine requires special skill. Anyway, we are not talking about only simple embedded system. We are talking about embedded system which is real time, right? That is where the challenge is. You should design the ISR such a way that doesn't hamper task 1, 2, and 3. Other strategy is ISR 1 is just invoke task 4, right? The task 4 is only run when the ISR is there. So what ISR do is ISR just invoke task 4, and task 4 would be run in the round robin fashion. So this is another implementation which is possible to facilitate interrupt driven task, right? One is the ISR has become task itself, and which will stop the normal execution of task 1, 2, or 3, or ISR will invoke task 4, and task 4 will now become a part of this super loop only once, right? This is how the smaller embedded system can be designed. Now the question is, how can we design this smaller embedded system? So one of the simple approach is use FSM, right? So FSM is a base of even several software design as well as hardware design. Nowadays people we are also using FSM for Mealy machine and Moore machine counter design, right? But FSM was classically used by various software design, and then it is adapted for hardware design, right? Now, there are many tools which support this FSM-based design approach, and that's exactly what we did while designing a telecommunication system design, product design, in Matrix Telecom. So we have written the software like FSM rather than writing the simple subroutine. So as and when any event happen, it will switch from one state to the another state. And that's exactly how the switch case and if else statements would be helpful when you are writing embedded system C code, right? And that's how the FSM can be implemented. So that's why switch case is one of the good utility for embedded C code to facilitate its FSM. Now let's take an example of how this FSM would be helpful for designing a smaller embedded system, smaller embedded and real-time system, where real-time notion is also there. So we'll take a design of the bread toaster, right? So first we have to devise that how many inputs are there and how many outputs are there. So inputs are timer, alarm. Other input, which is the bread is loaded or not, bread is lowered or not. Then cooking time has cooking time is over, right? So cooking time is the input that it should be cooked for even 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes. And there is a mechanical release button. There is a mechanical warm button. Then there is a smoke sensor, which is part of the system, right? The output of that is cooking element, means hitting cooking element. Then the buzzer, then starting the timer and the warming element. So now what we should do while designing this bread toaster is we have to isolate a system central controller from inputs and outputs. So we have to analyze what are the inputs and what are the outputs. Right? This is basically the normal system design approach. Right? And other thing which is to be done is what are the data stream we have to handle? Right? And what are the actions and data which are to be generated by the systems? Now, based on that, we can design first is input output table. So let's take the input table, the timer alarm, bread loaded, and then bread lower type. So there are different types of those inputs. The one of the only one input is having a type of byte, 8-bit, which is cooking time. The rate at which various input arrives is also available. The timer alarm is appearing at 0.2 hertz. Bread loaded is appearing at 0.01 hertz, and bread lowered is appearing at 0.01 hertz. Means it is 100 seconds, and this is 5 seconds. And output is cooking element based on bread loaded and lowered should be at the same rate of 0.01. The buzzer should be based on timer alarm, which is 0.2. Start timer also should be at 0.2. And the warming element also should be 0.01 based on the bread loaded and lowered, right? So this is how the rate and the timing notion has been introduced in the systems, right? I'm not going in more detail of this, how the FSM is being designed. It's part of the typical embedded system design approach. But the FSM is being designed with, according to various event. It goes from one state to the another state. And that's how various inputs and various outputs are generated. And let us take a case that for various output, we have designated various different tasks. So we have four tasks which is to be executed according to the inputs, right? So all those four tasks to be run. And for designing, how can we code those tasks for real-time systems, right? So now the example which I took was a very small system, right? So one thing we have already decided that, okay, we are going to have a multitasking solution, fine. So there are various inputs and various outputs to be handled, right? They can be handled at the same time or maybe at a different time, right? So that is what the main challenge is. So we have to recognize that, okay, that in this real-time application, this outputs and inputs are to be processed at different intervals and with a different scenario. Other methods which may require in real-time application is sometime while writing the code, it may happen that the task become too much heavy. Too much heavy means the line of the code has become too much heavy and it is likely to take more time, right? So in that case, what can be done is the bigger task can be decomposed into the multiple and semi-independent task, right? Here, this is important that it is a semi-independent task for concurrent processing. So this is actually for dealing the complexity, right? So what can be done is if we have a large size code, maybe of 1,000 or 2,000 line for single task, then that can be partitioned in the semi-independent task, not the purely independent task, right? So that complexity can be decreased for overall real-time applications, right? And those tasks can be separately run into the systems. Now, up till now, I've been saying about the multitasking, right? Now, why the multitasking is needed? So here I'm justifying use of multitasking. One is responsiveness of the dependable systems. Now, the responsiveness is like, let's take an example of the ISR itself, right? Now, ISR is handled separately than task, then ISR would be executed as early as possible, and then it would be serviced properly within a deadline, right? So this is how the responsiveness can be increased. And when it is divided into multiple tasks, what may happen is there is a separate task for each and every inputs. That each and every outputs we have considered. One may say that why can't we, I've gone to the previous slide here, that why can't we have a task according to the input, right? So one may design a system where each and every task is handling inputs. So here, if we are only focusing on the output, then there are four tasks. If only focusing on input, then there can be 7 tasks, or the blend of various important input and all outputs, then the number of tasks may be varying, right? So ultimate goal is we should design a system which is become responsiveness. Responsiveness means it should respond immediately rather than taking unnecessary delay time. Now, another thing of multitasking is we are introducing the simplicity. So it won't become much more complex, right? Because debugging is another aspect while designing is if you are going to design the code of the task with 1,000 line or maybe 1,500 line, and then you will have to debug the system. It would become very difficult to debug those 1,000 line or 2,000 line code, right? What could be done is you could divide those into the 10, or maybe 10 is too much high, but 5 subtasks each of 200 lines and debug it, right? And that's how what we can achieve is we can achieve ease of unit testing also. Right. So while the system is designed, then using multitasking, this unit testing will become very easier. Even this approach, I think when Dharmesh was my student, I think at that time we have discussed that, okay, this simplicity in dividing the work would be helpful for hardware design too. So that we call it as a parallel blocks with sub blocks design. Right, this is also helpful for the hardware also, right? Other advantage which is needed in current recent time is we can exploit multiprocessor hardware. So if we have a multiple task, then what could be done is, yeah, we can leverage the multiple process, multiprocess hardware, right? What could be done is each task can be run on different processors. Nowadays, it has become normal that we have quad core systems and hexa core system, even mobile phones, right? And that's how multiple processor, multiprocessors hardware can be explored, right? Now, coming to the different implementation variants, that what, how we can design real-time systems. One is, we have a hardware which is in the dark gray zone. We can write direct application. That's what we are doing in normal embedded systems. Yeah, this is how real-time systems can be implemented. I'm not saying that I require some other thing. You can design direct application and then use a bare hardware. That's how many room temperature control are being designed. Right? So no need to have multitasking. That's fine. This is a very good solution approach for small real-time applications. But as complexity increases and number of tasks increases, then we could go with cyclic executive mode. That is cyclic executive mode, or maybe real-time executive mode of the different applications. Right? Cyclic executive mode of application where this application is divided into multiple subroutines, and one by one, one subroutine is being executed. That is exactly what the cyclic executive mode is. So that is only, it's considered one application which is divided into multiple subroutines. The next thing is we have different applications, means different tasks maybe, and we are using RT, real-time executive. So this is another mode, fine. But if we have more number of applications to be run, more number of tasks to be run, it is always preferred to have OS. And that's exactly where the OS comes into picture. So this is a multitasking. Fourth one is a multitasking operating system, right? So you can make a design choices based on your application. So if it is a temperature controller, right? And that's what the main query is. I want to design temperature control room. Should I go with the multitasking operating system based system design? No. You can directly design bare hardware, right? Earlier, if we talk about the normal robot control, which student used to design, they go with direct application in directly into bare hardware. But now the complexity of robot design has become, has increased. There are many sensor connected even. Right now it is LiDAR sensor, IR sensor, then the motion sensor and other many various type of sensors, as well as communication interfaces are connected, and all those are to be handled. And that's why we have moved from directly into bare hardware to the multitasking operating system in those robotics design. Right, so there are various different implementation variants, and you can choose one of them. Right, so the first category directly deals with the embedded system, which satisfies the real-time criteria, and next two are preliminary simple real-time systems where scheduler is used. Right, and the fourth one is the multitasking operating system. So I would be basically focusing on the fourth variant in the stock. Right, so I'm going to focus on this four variant of multitasking operating systems. Now, see, one thing is, suppose someone have a question, then they can ask. I think instead of asking it last, I think I prefer that the question up to this PPT can be answered, and or else I can take answer at last. Question, all the question at last.
If someone has the question, they can unmute themselves and ask the question.
Okay, if no one is there, then I continue, and they can still ask a question at the end. Fine.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Now, as we have already decided that, okay, that even I have decided that, okay, we'll focus basically on the multitasking based operating system. So we have to decide that, okay, in which cases RTOS real-time OS should be used, right? So one question is, RTOS is a potential solution, but rather than, it's not a solution to be used for everything, right? Now, it is an ideal solution for the given problem, fine. But it needs to have a Goldilocks levels of complexity, right? So the unlock one, which has happened recently, is actually Goldilocks solution, where the virus and economy is balanced out, right? So it's like not too simple and not too complicated, not too much complicated. So where this RTOS is not desirable, when we have extremely simple problem, as I mentioned that there is a temperature control which is to be achieved for the room, yeah, you can design your own embedded system and then it could be happening at every one second level, maybe even every 500 milliseconds, right? So it's like we have two states and triggering alert, that's it. And there are only one or two tasks to be performed, right? Like motion sensor is also there and temperature sensor is there. So as and when the someone enters into the room, then motion sensor is activated and then this temperature sensor should be started. Temperature control is to be started. And that could be handled normally by without RTOS. So it is not desirable when you have very simple problems or one or two tasks to be performed, right? When it is desirable, is problem is more complicated. Like the device has to control several different actuators. Like I have told you that, okay, earlier there was anti-lock cruise control system where even RTOS was not used, right? Even airbag control, airbag inflate when there is impact. So there was impact sensor, that's it. And then it could be implemented without introduction of OS, right? But car has become much more smarter, then there are various actuators and various sensors are there. So we have a different range of sensors and those sensor value are to be stored in local storage, as well as different actuators are to be controlled, right? So it become multi-variable control systems. In that case, we require RTOS, right? So problem is to become more complicated. Other thing which is there in the system is we require some sort of network which is part of the system. Like if you take the car control, then CAN is there, right? If we talk about the industry control, then there are Ethernet variants for the industry, like HART protocol and Fieldbus and other protocols, right? So if we have such kind of sort of networks are there, then we require the RTOS, right? So it is desirable to use those RTOS, right? Because else it will become much more complicated to just write a bare application without notion of RTOS. Now, next question comes is, now, is it suitable to use RTOS for complex problems, right? Now, let us take a case of a complex problem itself that there are multiple networking requirements. Multiple networking requirements, like I have to serve a web page and deal with the user authentication in the complex and enterprise environment. That's how many even IoT-based, cloud-based systems are there, right? So we are, the students are designing various cloud-based, cloud storage-based systems. Should we use RTOS there? Right, like in such application, we have to push files into various shared directory, right? And with the different network-based file protocol, even NFS, right? So in that case, is it suitable to use RTOS for complex problems, right? I haven't written the answer here in the slide, rather I want to discuss it personally. My answer is no. you should not use RTOS for the complex problems. Those who are designing using Raspberry Pi for even many IoT applications or other application, we are actually not using RTOS. We are using embedded OS, where user authentication is also required, right? And that's why I told you earlier is RTOS is used when the system is not too much simple, not too much complex, right? So this is exactly what the Goldilocks level of the complexity is. If we have simple application, RTOS should not be used. But if it is too much complicated, then RTOS should not be used, right? So now, RTOS-based implementation is converting the super loops into the RTOS task. Now, left-hand side, if you see, is this is exactly how we wrote the super loops, that we have function 1, function 2, function 3, and each and every of them are their own functionality. I think, yeah, there is an error here, functionality 1, 2, and 3, fine, and they have separate functionality. Now, this is how we write embedded system program, that function 1, 2, 3 is executed in the defined sequence, fixed sequence, right, in the while loop. Now we have to convert the super loops into the RTOS task. Then it is converting a task into the never-ending loops. Now the while loop has been transferred from main to the function. So now task is having a never-ending while loop. Task 2, similarly, task 3 is having never-ending while loops. And the main loop is like creating a task 1, creating a task 2, creating a task 3. And this ampersand task 1, 2, 3 are the handles which are used by the scheduler, right? So there is only one routine which is being called, is a start scheduler. That's it, right? And start scheduler would be ever running, and which is switching a task to be run on single CPU. And this is exactly how you can convert your super loops into the RTOS task. Fine. Now, what are the advantages and disadvantages of super loops and RTOS? Super loops are actually great for the simple system, where limited responsibility are there. But if we doesn't have a system which is very simple, then what may happen? It may take unnecessary, one function may take unnecessary more time, right? And then it will create a problem for the next task, right? RTOS has become very valuable with a more complex system that have not only time-consuming task, but the main thing which is required while designing, converting this super loops into RTOS task is the responsiveness of those tasks. Because now this task 1, 2, 3 are in the infinite loops. Earlier there was single infinite loop. Now we have three infinite loops, each for each task, right? So if any problem is there in this while loop, while one of the task one, then it may create a problem to the responsiveness of the task one, right? So it should be, we should make sure that there is a good responsiveness of the task, and even when external event will happen, right? External event is one thing which is missing here in super loops as well as RTOS task is ISR. So that's a challenge for both implementation, whether it's super loop or RTOS task, is how the external event is being handled, right? Now comes to basic implementation. If I want to implement anyway, I think I want to implement the RTOS based task into the MCU. So which MCU is right for my implementation? So we have to narrow down those requirement. Is will it fit So good candidate for project is, will it fit into my design criteria? Right? So this is exactly what is required to be done. First is, will it fit? Now, can it run my all my code? And how much does it cost? And is it readily available? This is much more one of the most important thing which we always think that, yeah, first three are answered, but the solution is not available in the market, right? Not available in the country itself even, right? So this question is also important. Many times while designing embedded system, we only consider on first three and then last we don't bother. When answer of all three are answer of all three questions are obtained, we then look at it at the fourth question. Oh, is it readily available or not? And meantime, even 2 to 3 months are gone. Right? So while designing the core, what we typically look at is what is the physical chip size? Physical chip size is how much space it is going to take on PCB. What is the logical size of read-only memory and the RAM? What is CPU clock rate? The CPU clock rate is a very intelligent choice because we should not only concentrate on the speed, we should also concentrate on the power consumption, right? And that is why it is one of the intelligent choice in embedded real-time systems nowadays. And people are concentrating heavily, giving a heavy weight on the CPU clock rate. And that you may even observe in the scenario that the UAV and drones are flying time of 15 to 20 minutes, maybe 45 minutes. But if you want to extend that flying time from 45 minutes to maybe 2 hour, 3 hour or more hours, then this is the one thing which we have to concentrate, the CPU clock rate. Other considerations are how the interrupt are being processed. Is it processed by internal controller, which is nested vector interrupt controller, or external interrupt controller, right? Other non-technical considerations are price and availability that we must consider. And what are the hardware peripherals, right? Sometimes what we may do is we may overdo with our choices, right? Like a Raspberry Pi. Sometimes Raspberry Pi has many peripherals, but we are not at all going to use a Wi-Fi and other units, and many pins are not to be used, right? So there is always a choice between from the small microcontroller to the big microcontrollers. So first we have to list that how many hardware peripherals are required, right? And based on that, controller board can be chosen, right? Another important consideration is connectivity. So the connectivity means, do we require connectivity? Like specifically when we target IoT applications, then we require this connectivity. So whether we are going with the Bluetooth LE based IoT application or the Wi-Fi based LED IoT applications, then we should choose controller board accordingly, right? Other consideration which are actually luxury for many real-time system is memory protection unit, hardware FPU, DSP function, DMA channels, and communication interfaces, right? Other luxuries requirements are hardware crypto engines, timing hardware like PWM is there, and watchdog timer is there, then integrated analog channels, dedicated touch interfaces, display interfaces, external memory support, real-time clock, audio support, right? Those are some luxury features available and required for various embedded systems. And based on that, we may decide MCU, right? And one of the considerations nowadays happening, as I mentioned earlier, is power consumption is one of the criteria. That's how even energy efficiency is has become one of the important criteria for designing a real-time systems, right? Based on correctness, like new correctness criteria is designed. Similarly, new energy efficiency criteria, new power consumption criteria is also introduced in current systems, right? So that's how the power consumption has become important criteria in many real-time system is LP mode, low power mode, wake up time, how fast it can wake up from low power mode to the main mode, and the VCC, right? So because the power consumption is, static power consumption is proportional to the square of the voltage, that's why the VCC is also important. So it should be operating at 1.3 or 1.1, right? So based on that, controller can be chosen, right? Now, this is all about the hardware people, those who can look at it. But I am one of the person is software guys, right? So then what is to be done, right? So we have a software engineer, computer science student. Those may not be well aware of earlier core consideration we have taken, right? The software guy in the team will say that, okay, I'm ready with the real-time OS on other toolsuit. Now, which MCU should I use, right? So in the bigger team even, this is what one of the influencing question which will decide the MCU later on, right? So you may say that, okay, Arduino is there, but Arduino does not have OS, fine. So we should skip that Arduino. And that's how Raspberry Pi is chosen, that Raspberry Pi has not real-time OS, but OS is there. Right? So this is another perspective which we must consider while selecting the MCU. As electronics engineers, we may focus on those two first two slides, but as a product designer, we should also focus on the software perspective that, yeah, which tool suit is ready and whether the RTOS, which whether that controller is going to support RTOS or not, right? And that's why we have to dive into the gray area which resides between a software and hardware, right? So solution is that we should dive into the software and hardware. And now there is a man in the middle between software and hardware is, we call it as a firmware engineer. So firmware engineer finally decides that, okay, now fine. Yeah, you have a software problems. Yeah, you have a hardware problems. Let me decide that which MCU and which tool suits are proper, right? And that's why if you look at the job markets and then the firmware engineers are highly needed, right? Many times what we are doing as most of the Indian engineers are, they are very good at both, even software and hardware, right? So this is how the person can decide the proper MCU, right? Now, one thing which give a very good insight of both is, I think you can look at the slide. I don't have much more time now, but what I'm doing, you can look at this slide, which has given many RTOS, which are open source versus commercial, and which are supporting different microcontrollers. And this is one of the very good link where people can choose RTOS based on microcontroller, or people can decide microcontroller based on already chosen RTOS. Fine. So now another question which may come up is how to select right RTOS, right? One of the important factor as a in a education fraternity is cost, right? But as a designer, there are other things which is to be seen is a legal liability, performance, cost, ecosystem, vendor, and engineering preferences, right? So I think this is not to be discussed in detail. So I may directly skip to the next slide. That is tips and tricks for using RTOS. So one thing is whether we can, so there are various rules of thumbs which can be applied to RTOS here. So first is statically allocate the task and RTOS objects. Then statically allocate means we should be able to allocate rather than dynamically allocate. So because dynamic allocation of the task will consume more space, and we may not be able to predict it, right? So that may lead to the poor performance. That's why most of the RTOS tasks are focusing on the static allocation of memory, because if dynamically allocation of task is done, then the system may crash even. Fine. So next thing which is to be done is a default stack size based on your application need. So we have to change a default stack size, because default stack size is provided by the vendors, but we are the best decision maker of the stack size. That's why RTOS should provide a default stack size which can be changed. Fine. Other is the function that are called from task should be re-entrant. Yeah, this I will make discuss in while discussing the example, right? So these are the various trips and tick to be taken while using RTOS. Now, without wasting time, I'll directly jump to my selection and justifying it. So my selection across various microcontroller series is a ARM Cortex M series microcontroller. So this is I have chosen over other series of microcontroller. Is it will give a full blend of features which user designer can control even, right? And we can make even high complex embedded system using RTOS, right? One may say that why can't we use ARM Cortex A series where the application can be directly written, but I prefer ARM Cortex M series over ARM Cortex A series. Next choice, my choice is RTOS, or choice of RTOS is a free RTOS, right? Out of those many RTOS mentioned on this this link, OS RTOS link, I have chosen free RTOS, which I am, we are using free RTOS for next last even 7 to 8 years. Now it is free RTOS is taken over by the Amazon, and they are using it extensively. Earlier it was handled by the community. And now free RTOS is almost exclusively targeted at MCUs, and it is having the stable APIs, and it is very well suited for extremely low level design. Next choice after MCU and RTOS is which development board should be used. Once you decide the microcontroller, one thing is you should directly go with which development board to be used, right? So there are two choices which I prefer is STM32 discovery boards and other boards which have come up the market. STM32 is very well preferred community, but right now I am focusing on the Freescale Freedom KL25Z because I'm going to show the demo of Freescale Freedom KL25Z. That's why I have chosen this. Anyway, we have STM32 also, right? IDE is also important, right? So IDE which are free and proprietary. So one of the free IDE is STM32 Cube IDE, which can be used with STM32. ARM Embedded Studio, which is online free tool, and that is supporting many ARM-based microcontrollers. There are some proprietary tools, which is Keil Microvision, very popular. Free version is available, which is code limited. IR Workbench, Sega Embedded Studio, and Crossworks are there, right? But out of this, I prefer MCU Expresso IDE because I use a Freescale now, which is taken over by NXP, and this MCU Expresso is a typical NXP tool now supporting Freescale boards also. And one of the reason why I have chosen this MCU Expresso IDE is it is available on Linux also, right? While in Microvision, I don't prefer more over MCU Expresso IDE because Keil is only available on Windows, and mostly I'm using Linux based systems. So that's why I was looking for the IDE which is supported by the Linux PC. So STM32Cube IDE is also a good choice because it supports Linux as well as Windows both, right? So now, coming to the free auto scheduler, Dharmesh, or I think, how much time I do have now? I think it's
Sir,
already
5:25. You can continue five minutes.
5 minutes, okay. So now, okay, anyway, so if it is 5 minutes, then I'll directly jump to the free RTOS schedule. I think this is how the task can be created. Fine, I think I'll jump to this. Okay, now how task can be created and how scheduler can start, right? So there is an API called xTaskCreate, and there are parameters to be given. This is how the task can be created. And how task can be executed is we have to run another API called taskStartScheduler, vTaskStartScheduler, right? So let's take the example here. So what taskCreate is, one of the example of taskCreate is task1, and double quote task1, and then stack side words, right? This is a number of stack size which we are specifying. So task1 is the name of the function which is implementing infinite loop, right? As I told you that, okay, there is a create task, ampersand task one. This is exactly what task create does. But there's an associated function, right, which is running infinite while loop. So task one is the infinite while loop. The advantage of this is we can have n task and they can utilize a single task one, right? So multiple tasks can use a single function, that is possible. Vice versa is not possible, right? Task one is a human friendly name. This is just human friendly name which is used by the tool, right? So you can give your own name that, okay, this is task one is handling IR sensor, right? Stack size, what I mentioned, that RTOS should support changing a default size. So we are either we can leave it to the default stack size or we can specify our own stack size. Now, there is a fourth parameter which we create is a parameter, pointer to the parameter. Fourth parameter is pointer to the parameter. Right now, we are not passing any parameter. That's why pointer is not needed. So it's a null pointer. So we are not passing any value to the function. So if we are passing any value to the pointer, it should be specified. Value to the function, then it should be specified at the fourth parameter. The fifth parameter here is a priority. So we can change the priority here. So we can have two level higher than the priority of the idle task. Idle task is not running. So when you want to specify the priority of the task, it should be two level higher than that. That's why there is a parameter called task idle priority plus two. So that's exactly what we are specifying. So we can specify plus two, plus three, plus four, so on. The last is a task handler pointer. A task handler pointer is a task handler T type, and then it would be used by other tasks as well as the scheduler, right? So scheduler is typically using this task handler pointer, and it is also available to another task. And last is the return value, which is return value which is being used by the function, whether task is really created or not. It's similar to the error code which we are using in the C functions, right? Now the task function related to the task create routine is like this. So it is void name and the parameter which is passed by x task create function, right? And these are the local parameters. INT32_T is a local parameter. And then this is an infinite loop where the code is implemented. And last line is a task delete. So what will happen is when the task is terminated, that means now this loop is not at all operative. In that case, the memory which is consumed by this task must be relieved. And that this is exactly what task delete will do. So it will release the memory consumed by this particular task. Anyway, I think I'll jump to the direct functions here. I think you're fine. Okay, just go with this function. Fine. So what I have is I have two tasks created. One is a task one, another is task two. And this is just a simplest example. What it does is we simply print the task text that task one is running and task two is running, right? So vtask function is a common function used by both task one and two. If you can look at, there is a common name used, common function used by both tasks, vtask function, right? Now how the characteristic of this vtask function can be changed according to different task is the parameter which is passed. So we are passing different parameter to the vtask function. So parameter which is passed to task one is pc text for task one. Parameter passed to the task two is pc text for task two, right? So two tasks are created, right? Stack size is thousand, right? So now what it should do is it should print two different messages whenever the individual task is executed, right? So this is just a creation of the task, right? It will not be run automatically when task is created. It is just a memory allocation done to the task and the association of the function done to the task, right? Now, if you want to run this task, then we must run task star scheduler. So it is a vtask star scheduler. As in when this line is executed, then the associated task will be run, right? So it will be run in the time slicing manner. One by cooperative manner. Initially, task one will run and task two will run. How it will be run is decided by vtask function. So what we have is we have one variable which is ul, right? And that ul is used for different purpose here. What we are doing is we are fetching the parameter which is being passed, and we know that the parameter is character pointer string. So it is a character pointer, PU parameter, given to the PC task name. So this PC task name is a local variable. As I mentioned earlier, it is a re-entrant function, right? Anyway, I am using the common task function, but it's a different copy used by task one and task two. It's a different physical copy. It's a logical copy of task one and task two. And this is a specific infinite loop for the task function. So what it does is it will just print that string on the console, right? It's not doing any meaningful thing here. So you see PC task name. So for the first task, task one is running, then return a new line parameter, right? So whenever we print string PC task name for the task one is executed, it will print task one is running. And then next line of the code is just waiting. It's just waiting. It will wait for main delay. This is just passing the time. It will not do anything else, right? So this is how the two string would be printed, right? Now, as I think the time is not there, but I think what I'll do is I'll share this slide, and then this next slides are almost self-explanatory, which is for, again, problem is like here in the first example, the priority is not there. So next slide is mainly focusing on how those slides, how those, what I say, how those priority can be set. Right. So now I am coming to the demo directly rather than giving the priority. So the solutions are given. So directly I'm going to the demo. So just take time here. So what I'm using is I'm using the board here. I think I know whether it is visible or not. Yeah, I think it's not visible. Yeah, I think just a moment.
It is visible, sir.
The board is visible?
Yes, sir. Your entire screen is visible now.
No, entire screen is visible, but I'm talking about this camera. So this camera is visible or not?
No, camera.
No, sir. Your camera is not visible.
Oh, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn off the camera actually, right? Because
okay,
I use the camera for some other application. So,
sure.
Okay, so what I did is I have this controller card, right, which is a very low-cost controller card, very proprietary even. It's a Freescale KL25Z, right, which is connected to the USB. So there are two USB connections here. So the first one is for the debugger. The second one is for UART. Right now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to only use the debugger, right? The tool which I'm going to use is MCU Expresso, right? And there are various examples which you can download. So there are one thing which is to be done. Suppose I think even the student can buy this kit. I think it is merely at 1200 to 1500 rupees. Anyway, we got this is from ARM. Under the university program, they have donated almost 10 kits and the Kiel Microvisor license. So let us go with the first example of hello, just printing the hello. So I'm opening the code here. I think, Arik, you are able to see the screen now, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Fine. So because, so this is an example which is downloaded from MCU Expresso example templates. So look at the code here, the first line. Is this properly visible? Because I think font size may not be proper.
Yeah, it will be visible. It is readable if the screen is on laptop, sir.
Yeah, fine. Okay. So now the line which is highlighted is required for the controllers. If you just go to the slides, right? So slide does not have those lines. Slides has directly started from the X task create. Now, if you want to run the FreeRTOS code for particular platform, then what is required to be done is we have to initialize the pins and clocks and other debug console. That's how these three lines are. These three lines are not needed if you are running the FreeRTOS code on the Visual Studio or any other platform which are using, right? So main thing is fourth line, which is X task create, which is a hello task, and minimum stack size is taken, and the priority is hello task priority is 5-1, and no parameter has been passed, right? Okay, and no handle is there, right? No handle is there. Now what hello task is doing is hello task is just printing hello world, that's it, right? So what I'll do is I will try to run this code, right? Even the board is required to be connected because this is in the debug mode. So I'll go to the console here. So my cursor is the console. First I will clean the code which is highlighted and then build the code. The good thing about this tool is it is running on the Linux PC, right? And then entering into debug. Yeah, I think debug is starting. Fine. Yeah, it is already configured, so that's why we won't be able to see it properly. But I think, yeah, so it does the target discovery. And then, yeah, now we have entered into debug mode, right? And there are right inside, bottom right inside, the window is related to FreeRTOS. It specify how much memory is used by the task, how much stack used by the task and task list, how many tasks are there. So I'm running this code in the single step mode. First line executed, I think, yeah, I should skip. So next line. So now we are at the fourth line. Now fourth line, when you run the fourth line here, then task is created. So we will be able to see the task is created, which is a hello task. It is not running, right? It has used 32 bytes of stack usage only. Oh, right. And now it will be running. So like we'll get some message on the console. And if you just look at the hello world is printed. The hello world is printed. Hello world is only printed once. Why it is printed only once? Because we have suspended the task as it is executed once only, right? We look at another example, right? I have to terminate its debug session. This is just a toy problem. But I'll terminate the debug session. I think there's some problem in the debug termination, termination failed, but yeah, anyway, I have a way to terminate this. Fine. We'll go to the next example, which is a very good blend of IO and IO and periodic task. This is a very complex program to understand, but I'll just go to the main core of the function. Now, main core of the function is this two tasks which is created, right? So first task is a tickless task. The next task is SW task, which is SW task is that doesn't mean it's a software. The SW stands for the switch. The first task is designed to run in the periodic fashion. It will run at the regular interval. The next task will be run only when event happen. Right? So if you go to the function, associated function here, right? So there are other processing which is being done. Right? So interrupt and GPIO configuration and timer configuration has been done in this highlighted portion. This is what require for the hardware. You obviously should know the hardware properly, that okay, what is where that pin is particularly connected, right? And what is the whether it is interrupt is enabled or not, right? And what is the priority given to the interrupt? So if you just look at the highlighted portion here, that this is configuring the timer and the interrupt also, right? Three lines are there for normal configuration. Next four lines are for the switch. It is connected to a particular switch. So as and when that switch is being pressed, the interrupt would be generated, and then that interrupt would be executed, right? So this is a task related to the interrupt. Fine. Now, if we focus on the tickless task here, this is a printf message. But what it does is it will printing a tick count. Now, this tick count is actually updated by the pointer, right? So this tick count is updated at the pointer. So what is being done here is printf. And after that, that tickless count will go to the delay routine. So it will slip. That tickless task will go into the slip mode. right? So it will print only after that time delay sleep time, right? Now next task is a switch task. As I mentioned, is switch task is what it does is it will print the message and part of the ISR that is typically handled by the semaphore. And what it does is it will print that CPU is wake up by the external interrupt, right? So this particular example is having one periodic task which is run at time delay sleep, and next task is at the event, right? So what I'll do is I'll try to run this code. Now I am showing that, okay, how this debug will run. So debug, what will happen is I have pressed the shift debug. So earlier and the during first demo, it has not shown this window. Now as I press the shift debug, this is open SDA, which is CMC's DAP driver available. We can use other driver available also, but we require hardware for those three. But right now I have only connected USB, only normal USB cable to the kit. Okay, now you could see is now we have entered in the debug mode, and yeah, this task list is consuming more time. Fine. So I'm directly jumping through those ones. Right. Now this is enabled. So it should show message that, okay, you have to press SW2 to wake up the CPU, because we have enabled switch for interrupt. So this message is to be given to the user so that they can press the switch. And now I think this is executing. I think task is not created. I don't know how it's coming. That's right. I should terminate this and then. Yeah, I'm terminating this debug session and rerun it again. I think the task is, all the tasks are created. Yeah, so we have task running. Right, so this is running at every time delay. Right. So this is one of the demo of the periodic task. Right now, I don't have any wire to be connected, but there is a switch too. So pin related to switch two is sorted to the ground. In that case, it will execute SW2 and mention that, okay, this is CPU is wake up by the external interrupt. So there are two tasks. One is the periodic task, another is the event trigger task, which is related to ISR. Right? So these are two examples. One was a very simplest, and the second is much more complex. Even in this task function, what we could do is we could even handle UART and other peripherals. And what I suggest is you can download MCU Expresso IDE without even hardware, and then download those examples. So there is a good example called UART, where UART is being handled by FreeRTOS. There is only one task, which is UART task, and then UART task, whenever it receives and transmits something, then it will send the message. So this is handled, transmit and reception is handled through the RTOS task rather than normal driver program. Right? Oh, I think I should stop the debug session and then. Yeah. Now, next thing is just I'll take 1 minute. Next thing is what's ahead. The ahead is what about the IoT applications? Then edge processing on computer vision. Then RTOS to be used for artificial intelligence, and where there are resource constraint and energy constraint of the embedded systems. So there is one good solution of this classical problem what we discussed was finally is this, where we have chosen microprocessor 3 and 4 and ASIC is there. And now in this particular scenario, RTOS is to be used. And that is a good challenge, how the RTOS we utilize microprocessor 3, 4 and ASIC to handle the situation through this particular schedule. Right? So this is a final solution of the problem what we discussed. Right? This is this is a schedule which is there. So microprocessor 3 is running 4 tasks, microprocessor 4 is running 3 tasks, and ASIC is running 1 task. And then there is a communication between those T1 to T2, T3 to T5, T5 to T7. T4 to T8 and T7 to T8. And finally, it achieved the execution time within a 41 and the cost is 7, right? So there are plenty of iteration which has happened, and finally we arrived at the final solution where microprocessor 3 and 4 are used and ASIC is being used, right? And think about designing a real-time OS for this particular problem. And that is what my point of view is, what is ahead in real-time systems. Thank you. Any questions?
Yeah, thank you, Professor Pinal Kumar, engineer, sir. Participants can ask questions if they have.
Sir, one question is there from Ketan Patel, sir. Which MCU good for sensor node with limited energy?
Okay. So as per my experience, I think this you can use ARM Cortex M0 Plus based microcontroller, because that is specifically designed for the low power mode, right? So ARM Cortex M0 is plus. M0 Plus is even consuming 25% less energy than ARM Cortex M0. So the board which I have shown actually is based on ARM Cortex M0.
Okay, sir.
M0 Plus.
So I think.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
And one thing which is there in even this kind of tool is energy measurement. You can also measure the power consumption in this particular kit.
Okay, sir.
Thank you, sir. Now I request Dr. T.P. Dave, sir, to please extend vote of thanks.
Hello. Good afternoon to Pinal sir and all the participants.
Good afternoon.
My name is T.P. Dave, head of EC department. I also attended your sir webinar and also one training on LaTeX at our institute.
Yeah.
So similarly, that LaTeX training, this session is also very much interested. So I am thankful to you for delivering a webinar in organized by our department and institute. The subject is obviously very interesting among the students, and I feel the experts are very less who can deliver to this detail, as I saw in this webinar. So I am really very much thankful for sparing time for this webinar, and we will also continue the series of webinars and such like that as per the convenience and feedback of participants.
Yeah.
So again, I thankful to Vinal sir for sparing his time with us, and also Dandukya sir for giving us a platform, Google Meet. And we look forward for the, these are fourth webinars. Fifth webinar is tomorrow. So you are all participants are also invited to join that also at the same time. Thank you, sir. And I wish that participants will have some detailed knowledge regarding the embedded microcontroller.
So any question is there, you can send it to my official email ID.
Okay, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
I'll share this presentation to you so you can send this to the share to
yes,
the participants.
Yes, 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 sure, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, many participants sure. are interested in. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, unfortunately, I could not cover all the slides due to the time constraint, but
no, sir. Least... But you cover many things. Many
yes,
things.
Yes.
You start from basic and you cover many things, but
many
within
things
within a very short time. So it's great for us. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, okay. sir.
See you and have a good time.
Yes, sir. Definitely.
Thank you, thank sir. You. Thank you all. Now I request all the participants to leave the meeting. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.